woke up this morning, the whole world was yelling. I wish I was dreaming all that we'd been through. My soul has been searching for some deeper meaning. I know there's a kindness that leads me to the truth. When everybody's looking for another fight, when trouble's on the rise, no end in sight. Oh, Savior, won't you come and make the wrong things right? Let me be the place you start. Give me a clean heart.
Good morning and welcome to Lord of Life. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Thank you. Today is the first Sunday of Lent. Lent is a six-week period of introspection and reflection in our lives, and we don't include Sundays in Lent, and this will lead us right up into Easter. And the reason why we don't include Sundays in the period of Lent, which is a time of reflection and observation of one's life, is that the Sunday worship is always a worship of joy of the resurrection and the victory of Jesus Christ. So Sundays are always exempt when we're doing countdowns like that. So 40 days of introspection, 40 days of reflection into our life and what's changed about our life, what's changed about our world quite a bit this year, certainly, but no different, I would guess, than some of the challenges that other people have had in their generations as well. So I'm very thankful that we can gather on this day and this first Sunday of Lent. Our focus today is going to be on temptation. It's going to be on sin and how Jesus overcame that. And I think we can learn from that and apply some of that to our own life as we continue our worship this morning. You'll see what I mean. Let us begin with prayer. Holy God, Heavenly Father, in the waters of the flood you saved the chosen, and in the wilderness of temptation you protected your Son from sin. Renew us in the gift of baptism. May your holy angels be with us always, that the wicked foe may have no power over us. We ask this through Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord, who lives and who reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forevermore. Amen. Let us now continue this morning's worship by confessing our sins and seeking God's forgiveness. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and we cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart, and we have not loved our neighbor as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all of our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare unto each of you the entire forgiveness of all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our gospel reading this morning comes from Mark, the first chapter, beginning with the ninth verse. At this time, I would ask you to please stand for the reading of the gospel. At that time, Jesus came from Nazareth into Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. Just as Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased." At once the Spirit sent him out into the wilderness. And as he was in the wilderness 40 days being tempted by Satan, he was with wild animals, and angels attended him. After John was put in prison, Jesus went into Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God. "The time has come," he said. "The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news." This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise be to God. As we typically, as we gather to worship, we would always recite either the Nicene Creed or the Apostles' Creed. These creeds are similar in that they have three parts. They contain the part that we believe in God the Father in heaven, we believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, and the third part, we believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Before we recite or profess our faith, as we do each and every Sunday when we're in regular worship times, the question is asked by the presiding pastor or priest, "Do you renounce all the forces of evil, the devil, and all his empty promises?" And the congregation answers, "I do." Temptation. It's part of our human condition. It's the devil's attempt to take us off of our game, to take us off of our focus, to take us off of our mission in life, and actually to separate us from God. God calls each of us to be great, to do well, and to enjoy this life, and to enjoy this world, and to do the Lord's will, what God had planned for us when he created each of us and placed us in our mother's womb. That's what God has planned for you and for me. Nothing but the best. The devil, on the other hand, does not. The devil tries to cause us to sin, to take us off of our game, to take us off of our focus of God and doing what's right and what's good and what's uplifting, and to focus on other things. Jesus, for example, in today, Mark does not go into detail of the temptations, but the other Gospels do. He was tempted in three different ways, and I'm going to discuss that with you. Jesus was tempted to abandon the mission that God had given to him. He was tempted to go his own way, so to speak, and he was tempted to use his own power. Someone once said that opportunity knocks once. Temptation, however, just keeps on knocking and keeps on knocking throughout our lives. There are certain times, too, that we are more susceptible, I guess would be the word, to falling into temptation. And those times are when we're tired, when we're hungry, when we're famished, we're not at our best, we're weakened in body, mind, and spirit. We're not thinking clearly. And that's when we receive bad news or some stressful thing is happening in our family and our work. We don't handle it that well because we're not at our best. Jesus experiences these things today in our gospel as he is led. He's baptized by John in the Jordan River, and right away he is led out by the Spirit, by the Holy Spirit of God, into the wilderness to be tempted. It's interesting that when the devil first came into play, so to speak, into the scriptures, it's back in the book of Genesis. And during that time, the devil confronts Eve and Adam and tempts them to sin, saying, did God really say you couldn't eat from this tree? And they said, yes, we can't eat from this tree. And he said, no, you can. So he's trying to get them not to believe God, not to trust God, and to trust him instead, of course, they fall into sin and temptation, and that's when sin came into the world. It brought with it all of the things that we struggle with to this very day, including illnesses of various kinds. People think that, well, God is punishing me because I have been stricken with cancer or with heart disease or whatever. No, that's not what happens. That's just the sinful world that we live in. Each of us get touched with things in different ways. Just because you have not received or been stricken with a particular illness or ailment, that doesn't mean that it's not there and that it's not present. It's just that that's not what's going to happen to you in this world. Your temptations may come differently. But let's take a look at this season of Lent. It's 40 days, and that's the same amount of time that Jesus is led by the Holy Spirit into the wilderness. 40 days. 40 is an important number in the Bible. 40 days he's out in the wilderness, and it says he's with demons and he's with wild animals out there. And he's famished and he's tired. The two things that I just discussed are things that really take us off our game and weaken us so that when temptation does come, or bad news in some way, or a challenge, a struggle, we're not at our best in handling it. Well, when he is led into the wilderness, okay, by the Holy Spirit, he is going in pursuit of Satan. He's not, it's just the opposite of Genesis, when Satan came after Adam and Eve. Jesus is going after Satan to defeat him and to show him that he has been baptized, that he is the Son of God, and that his mission, his purpose, is to bring salvation to you and to me and to all. So he's going out into the wilderness to confront Satan and to gain his strength and to, again, confirm, or affirm, rather, that he is the Son of God. So here we have the temptations that Jesus is facing. Temptation in the Bible is very real, okay? And it's very important, and it's usually very specific. Temptation is putting something other than God in God's place and in God's will for you. And these kind of things happen to us from time to time. And it happened to Jesus. So how did Jesus handle these things? First temptation. Jesus is absolutely famished. He's been in the wilderness for 40 days. The devil appears. And the devil says to him, Jesus, you don't have to be hungry. See these stones? Turn them into bread. You have the power to do that. Turn these stones into bread. Feed yourself. Jesus responds, and he quotes Deuteronomy each and every time. This time he says, man shall not live by bread alone. It's interesting because when Moses led the people into the wilderness, when God freed them from bondage over in Egypt, he's leading them in the wilderness, and they were there again, the 40 number, this time 40 years. And God feeds them with manna from heaven, bread from heaven. Jesus refuses Satan's temptation to go ahead and eat now, Jesus. Turn these stones into bread. And he says, no. He says, man shall not live by bread alone. Jesus is going to become for us the bread of life. Jesus knows that he is not going to give in to the devil and to his temptation of when Jesus could eat. He could eat any time that he wants to. But he's out there to get stronger, and he's out there to face the temptations, the same things that you and I will face, because he wants to know and he wants to experience what you and I experience. Jesus was both human and divine. So he's out there, and he's facing and he's experiencing these very feelings that we have. So the devil leaves, and he comes back. The Bible responds and records this as, at a more opportune time. The devil comes back, and he says to Jesus, you know what, Jesus? You don't have to go the way that God is calling you to go. You don't have to go to the cross. You don't have to give up your life. And he takes them up on a pinnacle and he shows them all the kingdoms of the world. And he says, Jesus, just bow down and worship me. And I will give you all of the kingdoms of the world. It's yours. Jesus again responding in Deuteronomy, Old Testament book. And it says, we are to worship God and God alone. The other piece of that interesting thing, temptation, the devil is a liar and the devil is a thief. And the devil lies to Jesus and he says, just bow down to me and I will give you all the kingdoms of the world. All the kingdoms of the world are not the devil's to give. But it's the same kind of lies and deceit that the devil tries to use on each and every one of us. Whenever we're tempted, whenever we're challenged to do something that we know in our heart that we shouldn't do, we always seem to get the feeling or the thought, whether it's you yourself or a family member or a friend, to think, well, yeah, but I think I can get away with it. I know other people haven't, but I think I know a way. I've got a plan. I can figure this out. I can do what I'm not supposed to do, whether it be deceiving your spouse, or whether it be stealing from the company that you work for or doing something, you think, well, I think I've figured out a way I can do it. But it never seems to work out, does it? It never seems to work out. And that's because when Satan puts these thoughts in our heads to do these things, we always think, just like he's trying to say to Jesus, I can give it to you. You don't have to go to the cross. I can give you all the kingdoms of the world. Just take a shortcut. Do what I'm saying. I can show you a way around it. Jesus says, no, we are to worship God and God alone. The third temptation is he takes Jesus up on the pinnacle again, and he says to Jesus, throw yourself down. Throw yourself down, because Psalm 91, and again, Satan knows scripture. He says, Psalm 91 says that God has promised you and all people that he will protect you and that his heavenly angels will come, quote, lest you dash your foot upon a stone. Meaning, you could throw yourself down, nothing's going to happen, because God has already given his promise that he will get you safe, he will keep you safe, he will watch over you. Jesus says in response, Deuteronomy 6, chapter 6 is where all his responses come from, except for the one from chapter 8. He says, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test. And then Satan leaves Jesus. And it says again, he leaves him for a more opportune time. After the devil leaves and Jesus overcomes him with these three temptations, then Jesus begins his ministry. But it's interesting because these three temptations, the first one again, turn these stones into bread. That way you could eat. In essence, the devil is saying to Jesus, you know, serve yourself. Take care of yourself. Maybe God's forgotten about you. The Bible tells us God will always take care of us. He will always show us a way. He will always lead us through times of temptation and times of trouble. The devil's trying to say, oh, you know what, take a shortcut. You don't have to do that. Take care of yourself. Serve yourself right now. We too are tempted at times to be self-serving, aren't we? We are tempted to go our own way. And one of the best stories about this, one of the best examples, is the story of Abraham. When God called Abraham and Sarah was his wife, remember she was in her 90s? And God promises Abraham that he will have a son by Sarah. Well, Abraham and Sarah wait, and a few years go by, and they think, well, maybe God forgot about us. So Sarah says to Abraham, go in with my servant and lay with her, and that way she will conceive a child, and that way we'll have our child that God promised us. God comes back and says, what did you do, Abraham? What did you do? I told you you were going to have a child. Sarah becomes pregnant, and that's when Isaac is born. And Isaac means laughter, because Sarah laughed. She didn't think that God could be able to give her a child in her old age like that. And that's, I think, what a lot of us do when we're tempted by things. We look at ways and think, well, it's just not impossible for me to do this any other way. So I've got to cut corners, or I've got to do it this way or that way. Instead of reaching and pursuing greatness, which is God wants all of us to do, we try to cut corners. And that's what the devil loves for us to do. The devil doesn't want us to pursue greatness. He wants us to be less. He wants us to settle. He wants us to be everything that God tells us not to be. Everything that's going to cause us pain. Everything that's going to cause us to have a life where we don't have peace of mind anymore. Anything that will drive a wedge between us and our belief and our faith and our worship of God. That's what the devil is trying to do. I talked about the second temptation where the devil shows Jesus all the kingdoms of the world and says, it can be yours. You don't have to do it any other way. You don't have to die. Just bow down and worship me. He's trying to get Jesus to reject God and to accept Satan instead. And again, the third temptation, to throw yourself down, to cause yourself harm. Many times we do this unwittingly, or we kind of fall into it. People that become addicted to different things, whether it be drugs or alcohol or something. We start and we go, well, you know, I got this under control. People that overeat. It can happen in many, many different ways that just take us off our game and make us less than God would want us to be. And God is saying to us, and he's reminding us, and through these temptations of Jesus, Jesus himself is reminding us. You don't have to accept that way. We're called to stay focused on the Lord, and that's what these next 6 weeks are all about. We're going to be hearing the sacred stories in the Bible that talk about people, flesh and blood people, just like you and me, that are challenged just like you and me, and they're challenged through life, just like you and me. And we learn from them whether they did the right thing or did the wrong thing. We learn from that. I remember as a little boy with my brothers and sisters in Sunday school, and we'd hear the stories of Samson and the stories of Moses and Elijah and all of the people. And I'd be thinking about what they did and how they were able to do so many great things, and then how they fell down into temptation, and they started to do the wrong things, and they couldn't find their way out. And I always thought to myself, I won't do that. Sadly, at times, I have made the wrong decisions. And I've always tried to bring myself back to center and back to focus. But you see, God doesn't expect us to be perfect, because we can't. It's not a perfect world. But God does call upon us to be faithful, and we need to just keep that in mind. Don't be hard on yourself, because then the devil wins. If you start getting angry at yourself and taking yourself off the game and off of focusing God, or feeling that you're not good enough, then you're giving it in to the devil. You're handing it back. Don't give him any control. Ask God for forgiveness and move on. Begin today. Begin today. I know of a person who's been struggling with sobriety, and he had a fallback in his effort for attaining that. And I just sent him a brief text, encouraging, uplifting. I said, start over. Begin today. Our prayers are with you. And I think that's what we do for one another. And that's how we can be a witness and a help to one another during these times. It's always good to have somebody in your life. And I remember, you know, growing up, my mom and dad were always good at that. They were always good at encouraging us. You know, whenever something wouldn't work out, whenever there was disappointment, whenever there was a time where we failed, they would always lift us up. And they would always say, just like I said in my text to this person, start over. Today's a new day. So, the three temptations that Jesus faced are very real, and in many ways, they are the same temptations that have root and that the devil uses to try to get us. The three temptations. Pursue that which you hunger for, whatever it may be. Pursue it, he's saying. Want everything your own way. You don't have to do what anybody tells you. You don't have to follow Scripture. Just, this is your life. Live it any way you want. Yeah, we find out when we do that and we're not following laws and we're not following rules, that doesn't work out, does it? Well, that's the devil telling you, like he tried to tell Jesus, bow down before me and I can give you everything you want. Or seek your own glory, the last one. We are called in this world to worship God, to believe in the three tenets of the apostles and the Nicene Creed that we profess each and every time that we worship. We believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. It goes on a little bit more into fleshing that out, all the things that that means. And then the second part, we believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. And the third part, we believe in the Holy Spirit, that still small voice in each and every one of us that continues to lead us. Well, it's that still small voice now that is perhaps talking to you today as we begin Lent. And is starting to talk to you about reflecting on your own life. The things that you are doing that you would like to change. The things that you would like to do better. The things you want to work on. You know, whether it be in family or work life or neighbors or whatever it may be, what can you do that would take away that sense of anger that you have that seems to have taken over your mind and your life and everything? You wake up with it. You go to bed with it. You wake up with it. Something happens. It throws you off your game. It's just like Jesus when he was famished in the desert, you know. You're not able yet because it's constant and it's with you. You didn't get a good night's sleep because you've got all of that stuff working in your head. Let it go. Learn to let it go. Remember that you are a precious child of God, that you are sealed with the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever. As I said last week, that is the sign of the cross that is given to us at the time of our baptism. It's always there, and it always will be. And that's what we need to remember today. We begin the season of Lent, 40 days of reflection, 40 days of prayer and thinking and asking and trying to grow closer to God. 40 days of hearing the sacred story and applying it to our lives. I pray that these 40 days of Lent will be for you and for me the most significant 40 days of our growth in our faith toward God and in our love toward one another. Amen. Now we'll continue by giving God thanks. Gracious God, we thank you. We thank you, Lord, for the gifts that we have received this week. We thank you for the prayers we've received from the people here in the church and throughout the community. And we give you thanks for the gifts that they have given to help support the church at this time. Good and gracious God, we offer with joy and thanksgiving what you have first given us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions, all signs of your gracious love. Receive these gifts from the hands of your people on behalf of him who offered himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now let us continue with the prayers of the church. Relying on the promises of God, we pray boldly for the church, for the world, and for all people in need. In Jesus, your realm has come near to us in every place and time. God, give your church throughout the world a spirit of humility and repentance. Teach us to trust always in the good news of your salvation. We pray, Lord, and give you thanks for those responsible for our safety and for our protection. We thank you for emergency responders and police force and all their agencies. We thank you, God, and give you thanks for the gifts that you give to our physicians, for our surgeons, for our nursing staffs. We give you thanks for everybody that is taking part in being a first responder and helpers in the hospital for people that are in need. We give you thanks for our government. We give you thanks for our elected officials. We give you thanks for those who are in positions to make decisions that will make our lives better. We pray, God, and give you thanks for their witness and for their mercy and for their justice and ask that that would spread throughout the world. We thank you, God, for all your paths are steadfast love and faithfulness. Direct the words and the actions of leaders in our community and throughout our world, that we may maintain justice for all. Even, Lord, in the wilderness, in times of our own wilderness, you are with us. Tend to those whose lives right now feel desolate. Give healing and strength to all who are suffering this day. Especially, Lord, we pray for everybody that has been stricken with COVID-19. We pray for Sean Eubank, for Lynn and Dave, for Maynard, for Joyce and Cecil. We pray for Bill Maitland. We pray for Scott Newberg, for Suzanne Terrell, for Herb Trapp, for Jason Billings, for Butch, for Nancy, for Mary and Janet, for Marge and Bob, for Ella Wallace, for Alyssa, and for Kaylee. And we pray, God, for all of those now that we mention aloud or hold silently in our hearts. God, in the covenant of baptism, you claim us as your beloved children. Nurture us in our own baptismal identity and teach us to live within it for the sake of others. Strengthen this congregation's ministries of care and concern. In baptism, you join us to the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. We praise you for all those who have died trusting in your faithfulness. Bring us with them to the fullness of your reign. God, we entrust ourselves and all of our prayers to you now. We ask, God, that you would grant us these things that we ask for, and grant us also those things that you know that we need, yet that we don't know how to ask for them. Grant us these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And now let us pray together the words that Jesus taught our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now I leave you with the benediction that Moses gave to the people in the wilderness. May the good Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Briefly, in the way of announcement, I want to remind you that we are having drive-through communion, as we do each and every Sunday from 12 to 12:30. We are having in-person worship service at 11 o'clock. This is an abbreviated worship service. It's only about a half an hour long. So there is social distancing practiced here, and you are asked to wear a mask at all times during our worship service. And we hope that you will feel comfortable. If you feel safe and comfortable, please come and worship with us. If not, please watch us via YouTube, or come and turn your radio on, the FM radio in your car, to 99.3, and this microphone that I'm wearing will pick up and carry that into your cars where you are sitting in the warmth of your own car, and you can hear the sermon that way and then receive communion right afterward. I wish you all a great week. God bless you all. Amen.
I woke up this morning, the whole world was yelling. I wish I was dreaming all that we'd been through. My soul has been searching for some deeper meaning. I know there's a kindness that leads me to the truth. Where fight. When trouble's on the rise, no end in sight. Oh, Savior, won't you come and make the wrong things right? Let me be the place you start. Give me a clean heart. Clean heart. Clean heart.